Come, let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to the God who saves us. Let us approach him with praise and thanksgiving and sing joyful songs to the Lord. So welcome on this beautiful autumn morning. And before I turn it over for those who have announcements, I do want to mention a few things. And I don't want to preempt anything on the bazaar, but wow, I was really impressed. With all the rain, we had, I thought, a wonderful bazaar yesterday, and it was a huge success, especially with all those people who made it possible with their long hours and with their hard work for not only yesterday, but for many, many days before that. So I'm proud to be your pastor and to be associated with this fine church. And the bazaar was only an example of what you can do. And I know we're going to get some reports on the bazaar, so let me move on. A few other announcements I want to point out to you. Today, Pastor Costello of the United Church of Christ, your Sinus in Rockwell, will be having an installation service at 3 o'clock, and I've been invited to go and be a part of that. And so I'll be over there this afternoon at 3, and I'm sure if you should want to go over there for that service, you're welcome to. And then this Tuesday night, we will have Bible study. We normally have the first Tuesday of the month. This month we had a scheduling thing, so it's this Tuesday night. We are going to go to Acts chapter 19 and visit Ephesus, and you will see things that will amaze you, because Ephesus is perhaps one of the most well-preserved time capsules going back to the days of Jesus and the Apostle Paul. You'll see the very theater where there was a riot, and we read about it in Acts. You'll see pictures of that on Tuesday night. So that's 7 o'clock Tuesday night. Other announcements? Any other announcements? I know we have some more.
The Youth Hee-Haw and Dinner Show next Saturday night, $10 a ticket. Of course, if you show up at the door without a ticket, we definitely will not turn you away. But come out. They've done a pretty good job practicing last week, and I think they do have practice again this Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Okay.
All right. Again, last announcement on this, but if you're interested in coming to the concert for the homeless for Rowan Helping Ministries, it'll be November 4th and 5th. I have the sign-up sheet out there. It's my piano concert, and I'm going to take it Wednesday night after choir so that I can get those tickets. So it's been up for quite a while, but if anybody still wants to go, you can sign up for either Friday or Saturday. Today's anthem is an unusual piece, because it's one of my compositions. I rarely am able to compose because of time. Most of the music I do, about 95% of the music I do in church and in my own concerts, is improvised or arranged by me, meaning it's other people's works, but I do my thing with it. Well, today is a composition that I wrote back in the 90s. There was a set of four sonic exaltations, like you're exalting the Lord, four sonic exaltations that I did at the North Carolina Center for the Advancement of Teaching. It was an independent study. And the first one you've heard on organ, it was for organ and voice. It's the one that goes, well, I don't know if that's making sense, but anyway, that's the first one. Then the third one you've heard is that doxology and alleluia for the voices and organ, which goes, praise God from whom all blessings flow, then alleluia, da-da-da-da-da. So you've heard that one, I think, if you've been in some of the services here. This is the second one. And it's an old spiritual style song called Making Music in the Name of the Lord, and the choir does a great job on it. We've had fun with it. They felt like they were archaeologists trying to decipher some Egyptian hieroglyphics, because it wasn't published. It was in my handwriting. So we hope you will enjoy that and find it meaningful today. It's called Making Music in the Name of the Lord.
Good morning. On behalf of Judy and Mom, I will get report out on the totals of the bazaar. The bazaar, as of yesterday, brought in $10,279.15. I would like to, I'm sure there's a lots of thank yous out there. Would like to, on behalf of Diana, Shirley, and myself, thank everyone so much for the generous donations to the silent auction. We divide that out, as you know, we have baskets you can bid on, and then we also take some baskets and try to have a variety for a raffle, a basket raffle. The silent auction, the baskets that were bid on brought in over $1,400. And the basket raffle, where folks buy tickets and drop in tickets, brought in $684. So that was really nice. We couldn't do it without you. Thank you. There are some items left over. There are, I'll just give you a list: pasta sauce, tomato ketchup, pickles, tomatoes, canned tomatoes, cookies, frozen vegetable soup. There's chili beans, and that's marked with a C on the freezer on the left. There's also beef vegetable. It's marked with an S in the freezer on the right. There's also some frozen blueberries left. And we do have plenty of chicken and dumplings left over in the bottom of the refrigerator. They're in the quart size containers, so it would be easy to take them home. For the chicken and dumplings, the ladies are just asking for a donation, and I think everything else is priced as marked. There's also, if you're going to grab chicken and dumplings, there's also some coleslaw. I don't know if there's enough for everyone, so whoever gets down there early, there's at least some. So please help yourself to the chicken and dumplings and the other items. Thank you.
All right, like Kim said, it was a great bazaar. Really appreciate all the work. Of course, the guys in the Brotherhood appreciate you guys working so hard with breakfast. Typically, next Sunday would be our Brotherhood breakfast meeting. So obviously, we'll skip that and go to November. November. Wow, this is late in the year, isn't it? It's going to be Christmas before you know it. So we'll go to November as our next Brotherhood breakfast.
Knowing that it's late in the year, remember that we're having the Christmas play soon, and I need all the children in the church to come and participate in the Christmas play. So anyone three and up, please come. We will find a part. If we don't have a part, we will make a part for you. We will put everybody in it. Everybody will have a speaking part, and I need all the speakers that I can get.
And then at the same time, you've got the rehearsal for Hee Haw down there, okay?
So drop off your kids and then go.
And then come up to Bible study, okay? Yeah, it will be easier for me to probably move that than for you to. Okay? Well, we'll make that work. If there isn't anything else, let's begin worship. Let's turn to page 184. Thy Word is our choral intro.
Thank you.
earth is the Lord's. Everything in creation belongs to God.
Lift up your eyes, see the mighty works of the Lord.
This is the Lord's house. All who hope in the Lord will be called children of God.
Lift up your hearts, receive the gracious gifts of the Lord.
This is the hour for worship and song.
Lift up your voice, praise the Lord with all your might.
And our opening hymn is This Is My Father's World on page 143. Let us pray. Though I go up to the heavens, you are there. Or if I descend in the depths of the earth, you are there. Wherever I may be, you are with us, Lord. But we pray for your special presence with us right now in the Grace Lower Stone Reformed Church. Be with us, Lord. Inspire us especially as we come here to worship you and to praise you and to thank you. We repeat together our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
If anybody asks you, brother.
At this time, I would like the deacons to come forward as I read the call to the offering. Look around us today at this gathering. We are a community of people who love and follow Jesus. We share so much with early Christians who struggled in the work of the gospel, but also found joy in the Lord, joy in the life they share together. No matter what we are carrying this morning or what we face, we are not alone. Today, in this part of our worship, we invite you to share what you have so that others will find the same welcome and the same joy and love that we know. Let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. And the offertory is Alleluia on page 189. Let us pray. Lord, we lift up these offerings to you, and we ask that you would bless them. And Lord, there have been many other offerings through the bazaar as well. So we lift those up as well, Lord. We ask that you would bless these gifts and bless this church and bless the hearts that have freely given of themselves and of their financial resources. All for the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. Mr. Jesse Holzhauser has our children's message today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So we started a series last Sunday about the cross. Did you all wear your cross today? Dale, did you wear your cross today? Well, you guys wasn't here last Sunday, so I'm going to share with you. I'm going to give each one of you a cross, okay? And you wear that next Sunday when you come back, because we're going to do a series for a couple more weeks about the cross, okay? Now, we talked last week about what, Dale?
We talked about the cross.
Yes, we did. We talked about the cross. Is there two letters that you see on the cross? What's one of them?
T and L.
Okay, what does the T stand for, Christian? Trust. The trust that God has in us and that we have in God. Do you remember what the L stands for? Love. God's love for us. Well, today, we're gonna talk about the symbol of the cross, okay? So I'm going to share this story with you. The cross is a symbol of Christian faith. Because we talked about this last Sunday. You see crosses everywhere. You see them in every church. You see them on steeples. You see them at people's yards. You'll see one around your neck next Sunday. Right? They're everywhere. Anyone that sees the cross knows what it stands for. Knows that it stands for the suffering that Jesus of Nazareth went through. Roman soldiers severely whipped, beat, and made fun of Jesus before they put him to death. They nailed him to the cross and left him to die. They offered him drugs to kill the pain, but he refused. Even from the cross, Jesus said no to drugs. They took away his clothes and bet to see who would keep them. He was crucified between two thieves. Pacifiers and religious leaders said a lot of bad things about Jesus as he hung on the cross. They tried to make others doubt that things Jesus had said were true. Did you know that Jesus loves us so much that he died for us? Yes. It was a terrible thing that happened, but God meant it. God meant for it for our good, right? Some people think it doesn't matter, and it is silly. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is power of God." Our Lord took away our sins that day. He took our sins of the whole world for everyone that ever has or ever will believe on him by faith. A supernatural darkness covered the whole land for 3 hours at midday, just before Jesus gave up his spirit. Now, can you imagine? You see how bright and sunny it is right now outside? Could you imagine in the middle of the day it's pitch dark? That's kind of hard to believe. The powers of darkness must have thought that they had won. But as dawn came on the first day of the week, the tomb was empty. And Jesus had risen from the grave, and the whole world has never been the same. Would you agree to that? You know, Jesus died on the cross that day for us, so that we can live eternal with God. And that was a way that we could build a relationship with God. And we'll talk about that in the next couple weeks. So let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for taking away my sins on the cross. Help me follow you each day. Amen. Now this week, I want you to look around and find some more crosses, okay? And bring your cross next Sunday and wear it. We'll talk about it, okay? I'm sorry, Dr. Rob's going to be with you next Sunday. And he's got something special to share with you then. Thank you.
We'll move into the pastoral prayer, and of course I would like to have any special requests to include in our congregational prayer, and I want to fill you in on a few things while you think of anything else that we should add. We did have a request yesterday during the bazaar to pray for a young person, a 17-year-old person, Leland, who is having surgery. So we will lift that person special up in prayer. Eddie Warren is in CMC Mercy right now. Eddie had one of two surgeries on Friday. They operated on him for many hours on Friday, but he's doing well. I talked to Joni yesterday, and she said that he was even sitting up. His spirits are good. And tomorrow morning, and I don't know what time, it will probably be early, Eddie will have the second round of surgery, and it will be an extensive surgery. Basically, what they're going to do is reconstruct his back, and they've taken out a lot of fused bones in his back and in his, maybe the ribs and the pelvis. It's just really complicated. And so Joni's spirits were good. She said Eddie's spirits are good, and so we'll remember Eddie especially. Billy Gilmore is home. You know, he had to go into the hospital to have scar tissue removed and have his knee reworked on, and he did have an infection. So he's got a nurse who comes by, and he's taking something for his infection, and I'm sure that he's got therapy as well. But Sandy's busy being a nurse to Billy, and Billy's not where he would like to be, and so we'll remember them. And then I know Martha Holzhauser is continuing to have her treatments, and we'll remember Martha. I know of some other people, but I don't know about mentioning them to you in prayer, but we'll remember a general prayer unless they're lifted up or mentioned to be lifted up in prayer. I do want to say one other thing, and I'll get it to Sharon. I happened to go by and see Polly Boss because she did move, and she's in a sort of an assistant living up there off of Statesville Highway, and so she as well has a good attitude. She likes her place; it's very nice, and we'll put that in the bulletin. Her new address and phone number. Are there other requests?
Tamara Baylor's dad.
Oh, that's right. Mayford.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Others? Thank you. Others?
We need to remember all those up and down the coast that hit by the storm. A lot of them displaced in their homes. Some of them have been killed and different things.
Okay. Anything else? Thank you. Anything else? Okay, thank you, Johnny. Anything else? Well, then let us pray. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? Lord, we are amazed that you think of us and that you care for us in this vast universe. We are amazed at how you bless us, and so we thank you and praise you for all of your blessings to us and to this church. Lord, we pray that you would help us so that we might be mindful of you. We get so distracted in our busy lives from offering you our reverence and our devotion. So help us and guide your church all over the world that we might be as mindful of you as you are of us, that we would seek to be mindful of you. We pray, Lord, that you would build up our church and all those churches around the world that look to Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and that we could be that light in this dark world where bad things do happen. We remember, Lord, Haiti and the coast of Florida and South Carolina, where so many people have been injured or devastated, and then in Haiti in particular, all those deaths, and there were deaths in America. Lord, we pray for those suffering people and for all the damage that has happened, and we pray for your intervention and help. And we pray, Lord, that the church might be a part of the hand of Jesus reaching out to those in need. Lord, we pray for the sick and the suffering, and we have several people by name that we'll remember today. We pray for Mr. George Morgan. We remember our sister in Christ, Shirley Maxwell. We remember Mayford Carter. We remember Eddie Warren. We remember Martha Holzhauser. We remember Billy Gilmore. There are others that we all can think of that need healing hands, your healing hand or your help, and we lift those people up to you as well. Lord, we pray for those who are facing difficult circumstances or special troubles, and we pause for silent prayer at this moment. Lord, we remember those who have sorrowful hearts or troubled hearts. We pray for your comfort and peace to be upon them especially. Fill our hearts with joy and inspire us as we live out our days on this earth, and make us happy for as many days as you give to us. Lord, we pray for our leaders in our country and indeed around the world, that our leaders might be inspired by you to not think of just their own concerns or the concerns of their country, but to be mindful of those who are in need, to think of others, to think of the poor. And we pray, Lord, for your coming, especially because there's so much conflict in our world. We remember those who serve our country in the armed forces, and we pray that you would protect them from all evil and bring them home soon. And we remember those who serve us throughout many communities in the United States and in other uniforms, and ask for their safety as well. Lord, finally, we pray the prayer, the one that you taught us, the one that begins, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen. Let's rise for our hymn of worship, which is There Shall Be Showers of Blessings on page 430.
Let's do first and last verse.
First and last. Please be seated. And our scripture comes from the Gospel of Mark, and we're going to read from chapter 9, verses 1 through 13. And Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. Some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him, and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud. This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him. Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing what rising from the dead meant. And they asked him, Why do the teachers of the law say that Elijah must come first? Jesus replied, To be sure, Elijah does come first and restores all things. Why then is it written that the Son of Man must suffer much and be rejected? But I tell you, Elijah has come, and they have done to him everything they wished, just as it is written about him. The word of God for the people of God. And today, of course, we're going to talk about the Transfiguration. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. Well, years ago, one time, I was in a room with an older lady and a younger lady who were having a pretty personal conversation. I knew the older lady. The younger lady was having a lot of troubles. She basically was in despair or discouraged and defeated, and I can remember very distinctly Dorothy saying to her, God doesn't make junk, and you, my dear, aren't junk. And Dorothy was right. She wasn't junk, and you and I are not junk. But our world can be junky, and sometimes we can say we feel a little junky. In all honesty, we aren't the people that we wish that we were, or we don't live up to what we expect that we could be. It is true that God made us in his image, but we have a tarnished image, and we have a fallen image. So sometimes for us, the image of God is hard to find. But we see this image of Jesus on the mountain, this transfigured Jesus. And so this passage isn't just something to wonder about. It actually gives us a hope. It gives us a message. Today we're going to talk about this transformation. For Jesus was transformed, and so will we be transformed. So let's go into that scripture a little and move into some theological and spiritual meanings that are very relevant for us today. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power. Jesus, at the beginning of this chapter, actually makes this prophecy that gets fulfilled right away. What he's referring to is his transfiguration. He's referring to the kingdom of God coming with power and glory up there on that mountain. Jesus reveals himself to everybody. You know, it proclaims in the gospel, his light shines in every heart. But, you know, sometimes God and Jesus will make revelations, special revelations to people that are above and beyond what he normally would say. And I think Peter, James, and John were the recipients of special revelation when they had the privilege of the 12 to be the ones who go up on that mountain. You know, we talk about in tradition which mountain that was, and it kind of fits with the biblical picture. We think it's possible he was up on Mount Tabor, which is just west of the Sea of Galilee. And on top of Mount Tabor is actually the Church of the Transfiguration that celebrates this passage. So after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Jesus is transformed. And from the passage, we might possibly say that Jesus became light himself because his clothes are bleached beyond what any bleach could do from earth. Something very special, extraordinary, and, you know, beyond the earthly realms has happened. And we might say that Jesus was almost like light itself. And of course, God is not just light, but God figuratively is light, and Jesus, of course, is God. Now, something similar happened to Moses. When he went up on Mount Sinai, you may remember from the Old Testament, he went up to meet with God for a length of time, and he had been become light on his face to where people, their eyes hurt to look at his face. So something happened to Moses on Mount Sinai, but I think Jesus might have been even brighter. The point is that for Elijah and Moses and for all of us, God's presence will make us different people. God made Moses different, but God himself, Jesus Christ, is the source of that light that makes us all different. Now, Elijah was on Mount Tabor as well with Moses, and both Elijah and Moses were on a different mountain, and they both had special visits from the Lord. Of course, Moses received the law, and then Elijah had that visit by that gentle whisper that went and broke all the rocks. And before all the gentle whisper came, all these magnificent things happened, and then there was the gentle whisper that Elijah recognized as the Lord's presence. And that was on Mount Sinai, a long way from Mount Tabor. Well, one thing on a symbolic level, why do we have Moses? Why do we have Elijah? Well, we have Moses, for he wrote the Torah, or the law, the five books of the Old Testament. And then we have Elijah, the only prophet who did not die a natural death. Remember, Elijah was taken up. Elijah represents the prophets. So we have here the law and the prophets talking with Jesus Christ about the fulfillment of the Christ coming to our earth to be our Redeemer and to show us this glory from heaven. He is the glory from heaven. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. And so Peter, James, and John were very blessed to be up on that mountain, and something very special was being shown to them, but they were ignorant and frightened. So what's Peter talking about with the three tents? Well, we know that they were frightened and they didn't know what to say, but perhaps when he was stumbling around with the situation, he thought back on Moses in particular, who was up on Mount Sinai for 40 days. And if you were on a mountaintop for 40 days, maybe a tent would be a good thing. Perhaps that's what crossed Peter's mind. But, you know, he's thinking earthly, of course. And we have this glory of heaven being shown. But that's speculation on that passage. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." So the Son of Man has been revealed to Peter, James, and John. The glory of heaven has been revealed, just as Jesus had predicted that it would be shown. And so Jesus has not only been revealed to them, he's been revealed to us by the scriptures, which are inspired of God. The transfiguration, or the transformation of Jesus, means the fulfillment of the law and the prophets, that God would send his very own self to redeem us. And this transfiguration of Jesus to Peter, James, and John, and to us, unfolds a lot of very important theological and spiritual things. St. John, who was up there on that mountain, writes to us in a letter about the meaning of the transfiguration. "Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure." That segment from a letter from St. John gives puts this into perspective. These people could see not only, especially for John, not only did he see the transfigured Jesus, he had seen the risen Jesus. And he gives us this perspective. We have this hope, and so we purify ourselves to be pure like he is pure. And so we're all made in the image of God, and this is all through the scriptures, things like this. We're special people. We're not junk. Oh, Lord, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. So we have this specialness. All of us do. And for those who believe in Christ, we're even more special, for we are the very children of God. And so we hear some more about this from St. Paul, who echoes what St. John says. St. John says we're the very children of God. And then St. Paul tells us something else. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. You're the children of God, and you are vessels of the Holy Spirit. And although you are treasures in these bodies of clay, we are all still weak and sinful people. The promise is this: we will be changed. And change begins to happen to us when we first come to the Lord. We're all born in the image of God, and something special happens when we come to Christ as our Lord and Savior. We become the very children of God through our faith in Christ. And as children of God, we still experience the struggle between being tarnished people, maybe junky at times, and that image that Jesus gives to us, that transfigured image. And so we have moments in both worlds. You know, we move from the good to the bad and back and forth. And so this is the spiritual principle that we have. As we submit to God in everything, God is able to work within us to change us. So in a moment, if I choose to be junky, God will let me be junky. And if I choose to nurture the pure Holy Spirit, God will help me to nurture that pureness in the Holy Spirit. God will strengthen us in our purity, and that's the source of our strength. We are weak people, and our strength is the Lord Jesus Christ. And St. Paul as well declares that we will be changed as well. And he echoes what St. John says. St. Paul notes this: we are being transformed into Christ-likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So, friends, we are special people. We aren't junk, as Dorothy said. So, don't treat yourself like junk. Obedience to God's commands as Christians is not how we obtain salvation. We don't get to heaven that way. We obtain our salvation through Jesus Christ, in whom we believe. He is our salvation. But God's commands are still very relevant to us as people of God. They show us the way to purity. So we strive to be pure as God is pure, and we do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we're going to fail. We'll break the rules, either intentionally or not intentionally, by mistake, that we don't get discouraged, for we know that we will be transformed. So there is another final lesson in all of this. You're special, and everyone around you is special. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Perhaps the best way to talk about this final lesson is that, you know, each day when we wake up, we can pray, let me see the Jesus that's in all of these people that I'm going to meet today. For as you are special, Jesus has touched you special, and you are being transformed, and we try to do the same with the others. And I know it's hard, because I try this too. And, you know, sometimes people are junky, and they don't make us feel very nice. But that's our lesson. God doesn't make junk, and so we honor the creatures of God, and we honor the presence of God in others. So again and again, we come back to this transfiguration lesson. As Jesus is transformed, we will be transformed too. And so we have this hope, and so we purify ourselves as he is pure. Amen. Our closing hymn is, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Second verse.
Skip the second verse on this hymn.
Bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his eyes upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord smile upon you and grant you peace. So, my friends, may you be transformed as he is and purify yourselves. Go in peace. Amen.